Right, so Sue and Kelvin, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. So firstly, let's learn a little bit about you two as a couple. You've been together for what, 30 years, is it? Can you tell us about how you met and married?
We got together first and then we were together till 8 years, something like that. And then we got married in 2001. At where was it? Where did we get married?
Oh, at Pendle Hill.
Pendle Hill.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah. Nice.
Because we like it round there.
Yeah.
I come from Southport. Sue comes from St Helens. So I moved to St Helens with my job. And then, you know, we got together then.
Yeah. So you were both nurses, weren't you?
Can yes.
You tell us a bit about that. And you met through nursing.
Yeah.
Yeah. We were both learning disability nurses, which are a speciality. I trained at what is equivalent to Ashworth now, and then I left shortly after and went as a community nurse, supporting people with learning disabilities in the health needs mainly. And then I was asked to open up a number of homes that were people discharged from the old large hospitals. And then I was asked to open up a admission assessment unit and then eventually to service manager. But we met.
You interviewed me for a job.
I interviewed you for a job.
Wow. So was that the first time you met?
Yes. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we would both been married before. We've both got children. We've got eight kids between us, 20-odd grandkids, some great-grandkids now.
Wow.
So it's a big family. And we've got family in Canada, Birmingham. They are spread about, you know.
So
Southport, Lancashire.
So you both retired, didn't you? And then tell us about the beginning of your retirement and, you know, what you sort of planned to do. And then obviously it changed a bit, didn't it?
Yeah. I retired at 60 because it was the right time to retire and the health service was becoming quite bean countery. So I retired and got a job working was the easiest job in the world, for insurance companies doing medical interviews. So I did that for about 7 years and Sue said, you've had enough, retire. So I retired. But in the meantime, earlier on than that, we'd done this cruise, which we met a couple who were foster carers and said, you two should do it. And I said, but eventually I agreed to and not looked back since.
Yeah, so Sue, you really wanted to do it, didn't you? But Kelvin took quite a few years of persuasion, didn't he? Tell us about that.
Kelvin took 8 years to persuade. I love kids. I love young people. I love challenging myself. I love new experiences. And life is so boring and not very fulfilling when you're retired unless you've got things to do. Our life plan was we were having a property built in Cyprus. And we lost some money when the financial crash came and the house was not going to be worth what it was costing to build. Yeah. So we pulled out of that, cut our losses. We had an apartment in Turkey instead. We had a caravan at Ribby Hall in Lancashire and we were going to spread our time between England and Turkey and Canada with the family. And I was so homesick. I was rubbish. I missed my family. I missed my granddaughter, particularly who I'd looked after since she was 5 months old. Mm-hmm. And I said to Kelvin, I can't do this.
Yeah.
So we ditched all that. That went out the window and we sort of started again. We moved back to St Helens and I started to talk to Kelvin about, let's foster, let's do something that we can give back and just something that's interesting for us.
Yeah.
And I went on and on and on and nagged and eventually he agreed that the first step would, and this didn't cost anything, just contact an agency and let them talk to us about fostering.
Yeah.
Just let them answer our questions. And then we won't make any decisions until we've heard what they've got to say. And let's just take it one step at a time.
Yeah.
And I, at the time, didn't feel that we were good enough that we would be able to do it. I didn't feel that we would. I thought the bar was really high. But they basically just want people who are resilient, where you can cope with a few ups and downs, not massive, but just keep going. And people who are kind and can listen and open-minded,
yeah,
you know, and that's basically what happened.
Yeah.
And they came and talked to us, didn't they? And
they did.
Then it went through the whole, well, we even enjoyed the assessment, didn't we? That was quite fun.
Yeah, so we'll talk more about that in a second. But just firstly, going back to, you know, that sort of subject of retirement, I think retirement isn't a one-size-fits-all thing, isn't it?
No.
I think that, you know, we all think, oh, we work and work and work for years and then, oh, we can't wait until we get to put our feet up in the Mediterranean. But it's not always how you think it's going to be, is it?
It's so not how you think it's going to be. And for anybody that hasn't got a family or ties, that might be fine.
Yeah.
You know, or for some, but I think that would just get boring. I think as human beings, we need to feel fulfilled. It's not just about money, it's about feeling useful. And your usefulness as you get older diminishes greatly. And it's not a great feeling. It's, you know, how women become invisible as you get sort of middle-aged, you know. Well, older people become invisible too. So a way of maintaining visibility for us has been having our foster family and the fun and the challenges that's brought. It's been fantastic. I just wish I had done it. I wish I'd persuaded him. I wish I should have given it work 15 years earlier. Forgot Cyprus and all the rest of it and just get kids.
Mm-hmm. So going back to the couple on the cruise that you met, you know, what was it about their story and looking at their life? Did they have kids with them on the cruise or were they just by themselves? Or what was it about them that sort of made you think, we could do that?
We ended up we ended up on a table with two police officers, two military people and us. So the game we played was, guess what we do for a living?
Okay.
We guessed the police straight away. They guessed us straight away, your nurses. They could tell.
Really?
Yeah. The military people were a bit not so attuned as, say, the police. This police couple had been fostering for years and she was on the board of an agency in Wimslow and was really trying to recruit us. Kelvin was ready for running a mile. He was. But the sort of the seed was planted.
Yeah.
And we thought then by the time we got round to it that we were too old. But it's kept us going. It's kept our minds active. It's been great. Yeah.
So can you remember when you first started the process, you know, being worried about those things that you thought might hold you back and then realising that actually, you know, you were able to? Like, can you remember that?
Absolutely, those things. So that, one, that we were too old. Two, that you hear all these stories about all these awful kids who were out there. We know lots of foster carers. We've not met any awful kids. We've been fostering for 6 years and in that 6 years we haven't met any awful kids. They all have needs and they've all got something to give back to you as well as what you can offer them. The training we've had from Fostering Solutions has been on time. It's been what we've needed. There's the statutory training which you need for Ofsted, but also special interest training, things that were just relevant to us and our kids. And the other thing Fostering Solutions have provided was a service by a lady who's a psychotherapist, helping us with all the attachment issues that the kids had, so that what we were doing was targeting the needs of our specific children. That's invaluable. That you struggle to do that on your own, and you don't get that everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So we're grateful to them.
Yeah.
And therapeutic parenting or attachment theory wasn't a thing when I trained as a nurse.
No, yeah.
There was no such ideas or theories. But, you know, clearly we got there. It helped us, didn't it?
Yeah. It's standard now for people. So there is enough training. There's plenty of training. And there's still time, room to be yourself in there, to make it, do it your way.
Yeah.
Based with that bit of knowledge to support you and back you up. The other thing we've had, which is, I think we've been very fortunate, we've had the same supervising social worker all the way through. And she is a superstar. When we do stop fostering eventually, I'd be really sorry. Oh, we keep her as a friend. You know, I'd be sorry to lose her. So, yeah, it's been a very supportive organisation.
Yeah. So going back to your assessment and your initial training and then, you know, going to panel – and finding out that you've been approved. Like, tell us about how that felt. How did that feel, Kelvin?
Because of my job, my role in the past, I've been in front of that many panels that it didn't say. Was I worried? A bit, but it wasn't the end of the world. So it wasn't a great... Well,
it was very informal. I remember being in a wheelchair. It was very informal. They had someone representing foster kids. Mm-hmm. Think questions we were asked, like, was when you get your first foster children, how would you make them feel at home? And my reply was, I'd spoken to my grandson about this because he's very, he thinks a lot, one of my grandsons anyway. Mm. And he'd said, well, you need to make them the favourite food. Mm. So if these are asylum seekers and they're from Syria, you need to make Syrian food and find out what they want. Well, probably wouldn't have time, but that was the answer I gave. And they were impressed that I'd spoken to the kids about. So it really is, it's not rocket science, it's just about communicating and listening. And there was another question from a guy who was a trainer, and he asked about what would you do if you had kids who were aggressive, and our answer was, well, we have worked, because of our learning disability background, we had worked with people who were aggressive, but there is training, but we've had no experience of aggression from our children. They might have been sad, they might have been angry, but there's not been, you know, it isn't like that. And the training you get would support you to manage that. There would be reasons, well, if parents hadn't turned up for contact, you know, something like that, and the child is really, really upset. You know, you wouldn't want to punish a child, you would just want to hold them and make things better, wouldn't you, and listen to their point of view. So it isn't rocket science.
So it's been 6 years that you've been fostering now. Mm-hmm. Are there any placements that particularly stand out, or maybe your first one, or maybe placements where you felt like, wow, we really learned something there? You know, is there anything that particularly stands out?
We've only had two basic placements. Yeah. Obviously, three people, but two placements. And the first was somebody who was only with us a few days. And then
we got her from the police station.
Yeah.
And she was only 11. And she shouldn't have been in the police station, but she had become very angry because her foster carers were turning the internet off as a punishment for her. And that's a big thing for she was 11, for a young person. And that the internet was her only contact with her siblings. She was one of seven. I think there were other ways they could have... I would suggest turning the internet off without some kind of negotiation, you know. So she'd become very angry, and they'd taken her to the police station. She stayed with us for about 6 days, and then she went into residential care. But it's a shame. That's the thing, that maybe that was a lack of skill with those carers, you know, whereas rather than just treat it as a, do you feel better now? You've, you know, instead of, oh, you can't do that. But I think sometimes as foster carers, we don't trust ourselves to do the right thing. Mm. And we're quite afraid of what these kids might bring with them. And what I've found, what I've learned is that they don't bring anything but a young person that needs support and nurture and looking after, and that you can do it. And you get to the point where you think, oh, God, I've had enough. And then you need a break, and that's okay, you know, but you can do it.
Yeah, so you've got young people now on a staying put order, haven't you? Yeah. So they're, what, 18 and 19?
Yeah. Yeah.
So tell us about that, you know, and if you've got a young person with you who becomes 18, you know, what happens?
What can happen is that often happens is those children then move on and would live in sheltered housing, or the local authority has to find accommodation, and they get benefits and stuff. With our two, one, like your own kids of 18 and 19, wouldn't be ready to move on. They're very settled and comfortable. The elder ones at universities, at the second year at the University of Liverpool, and the younger ones at college doing an animal management course, A-level standard. So for them, it was like, if it's not broke, why change it. They wanted to stay with us. So the stay in put scheme is a scheme that all local authorities have, and it's something that's been pushed by the government, where children, when they get past 18, they become care leavers. They're no longer in care, but they can stay with the, within the foster family. We get a payment from the local authority, and the children make a contribution as well. And so it's just like your own kids staying at home and giving you a bit of money towards the food and stuff. So it's exactly the same. They still come on holiday with us. The planning Christmas, weighing up the fact that, that now they're adults, will they get as many presents under the tree? Because we're all children at heart, aren't we? You know. So yeah, staying put. It's our first experience, and probably will, because of our age, will be our only experience. But there are no plans at the moment for them to move on. But the good thing is that looked after children and care leavers are entitled to support from the local authority until they're 25. So there is what they call a personal assistant who is with the local authority, who keeps in touch. They have a plan. Local authority know what the kids' plans are, what they're planning to do, where they're going to go. And when they're ready, they will support them to move on. Mm-hmm. So it's working okay.
So how long have those two young people been with you now? Quite a long time, isn't it?
Nearly 6 years.
Nearly six years. They were 12 and 14 when they came.
Wow. So what's that journey been like, you know, seeing them grow and develop and milestones in their life that you've shared with them? What's that been like?
Initially, the first few years, it was up and down.
Yeah.
And not because of their fault, because of family circumstances. They were absolutely fine. So, but we worked through all those issues. Now it's just the normal teenagers, no different to any other teenager. They don't actually go out clubbing it or anything, or smoke or drink or anything like that. They have an odd sip and just, I don't like that. But that's fairly normal amongst the teenagers now, I think, anyway. So the journey has been good. We've had some issues with...
Again, lots of support from Fostering Solutions. Yeah. They've kept us going. They've kept us going, and they've got... The other thing they have is they know the children, and they've got a relationship with the children as well. Mm-hmm. So you're not on your own. You do end up with a wider network of support. Yeah. Yeah. And our kids are friends with other foster kids, and we meet up with other foster families. So we might have Sunday lunch. There's a D&D group where they all go and play D&D for hours and
get Dungeons and Dragons.
It's quite the thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
And then whoever's hosting that will make tea for everyone. So we all go and just have tea while the kids are playing D&D. So you know, it's not like you're stuck in your little house with these children and you don't know what to do with them, you know.
Yeah.
And so the money you get isn't massive. I mean, we didn't look into the money when we first went into fostering, did we?
No, we just got paid.
But it's enough to allow you to get a little bit, and for you to give those kids the type of life that they would choose and that you want to give them. So we've done lots of theatres, lots of cinemas, we've done zip wires, we've done centre parks, we've done Cornwall, visiting their family, where their family, we even go out for dinner with their family, with some of their family in Cornwall. We've been to Gran Canaria, they've been to Amsterdam, been to Paris. So we wouldn't have done any of them things without those kids.
But the eldest took her mum. Her mum, who's had some great difficulties in the past, took her mum and the younger one to Amsterdam for 5 days. She planned it all and
paid
took them off.
It.
Paid for
it. Mum had never flown, never been on a boat.
Her mum is half Dutch and has never been
to Holland.
Wow. So it was just, And still, her mum still has the difficulties, you know. But their relationship is much better.
I think when you start your fostering journey, you will be at, it is normal to be anxious. That first few nights when you've got somebody else's kids in your house, it's like, oh my God, can I do this? But it does settle quite quickly. Mm-hmm. And there are times when it's quite difficult, but there is support around you. And as long as you recognise that you're in it together, you're not on your own, and the kids, you know, are working with you, then it is very, very rewarding.
Yeah.
From time to time, we do talk about what was it like when you first came? And they'll say something. Oh, I didn't know that went on.
Yeah, they didn't know the family. After 2 weeks, they said, we didn't know families like yours existed.
Well, we thought
all families were like ours. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, they all fall out and they don't talk to each other and they all hate one another. And they didn't know that it was, they didn't know about repairing relationships if you have a fallout. They didn't know about hugs. Nobody had ever put them to bed. You know, nobody had ever said, go and have a bath or just basic stuff. It's not, as I said, so many times, it's not rocket science. Last night, I was having spaghetti and our cutlery drawer jammed. And so I had to eat the spaghetti with a spoon and the kids had gone to the cinema. When they came in, we said, we've got a challenge for you. We can't open the cutlery drawer. So got a screwdriver out of Kelvin's tool thing, front off the drawer, handles out, took it all to pieces, all the drawer out, back, straight back in, there's your fork. That's foster care. So talent, when discovering the talents and abilities of children, that it's amazing.
And they're both very different talents and skills, haven't they?
Yeah.
But, you know, they are something else.
And when you realise, you know, that you could give these children and young people these, you know, these simple things, love and care and protection, that they wouldn't have had otherwise. How did that make you feel? Did it feel quite shocking, really, to realise that?
It was really shocking to realise what they'd lacked, and that what we had was very simply just being us was enough. And then with all the extra support when we've needed it, you know, whether it's been guidance or training or a bit of reading or, you know, reflection on something that's happened. Yeah, so it is shocking. It's shockingly doable.
Because in the beginning, you know, you said you felt the bar was too high, you felt like you weren't right for it, when really it's ordinary people that are needed, isn't it?
Absolutely.
That can do extraordinary things in the smallest, most simple of ways, isn't it?
Yeah. And that it is exactly that. And even a foster carer somebody told me this ages ago, a foster carer on a bad day, and you will have days when you think, oh, not up to this, is better than a bad parent. You know, those children are still in a better position with you. And I think the fulfilment we've got from it, I just wish we could share it, you know, because it's awesome, yeah.
Yeah, and when you sort of, you know, you think about the early days of your retirement when it was initially going to look quite different, wasn't it?
Massively.
You know, you were going to go and put your feet upon a beach and, you know, and then you decided to do something different. You know, how does it feel now to think, wow, this our life could have been so different? As you say, you wouldn't have had these young people in your lives, would you?
No, I wouldn't change anything. I don't think we'd have felt alive, would we? We feel alive now. You know, part of we are part of a bigger family, but our little foster family, our little core is great. You know, it's really works. I mean, they don't always like washing up. You know, but
no,
they're
different
good,
to any
but
other
good
teenager
at mopping. You know.
But if there was anybody, you know, watching or listening now that are maybe approaching the same sort of stage of life that you two are in, you know, looking at the retirement, thinking about what they want to do, how would you sort of sell fostering to them, I suppose? You know, how would you, going back to the couple on the cruise, you know, if you were to tell other people about it?
I think you've got to plant the seed and think, have you thought of fostering? And people usually immediately try to talk themselves out of it. I would suggest they take that first step and talk to an agency like Fostering Solutions, who are very experienced. They've got lovely people who work for them. And you'll be in a better position to make a decision based on the information they can give you. Mm. Otherwise, it's all sort of up here rather than anything practical. And you can go at your own speed. There's no rush and you can back out at any point.
So it sounds like fostering has been, you know, such a positive thing for you both in your retirement. How would you say that it has changed your lives? In what ways? What have you learned?
I've learned, gosh, what have we learned? I've learned that it's not a quick process. You know, helping, supporting young people, it doesn't change quickly. You can't turn them into clones of your own children. They are themselves. They are who they are. They will have, in my experience, they have massive hidden talents and advantages, and exploring them, finding them, enabling them is really worthwhile. I think most people can do it, you know, and you don't necessarily need to have a lot of physical energy if you can just be with someone. Being with someone when they're struggling is one of the hardest things you can do as a nurse. Yeah. And it's exactly the same in fostering. If those children are struggling, just being with them, being there for them, having their back, if you can do that, then the rest of
you're halfway there.
Yeah, you are.
So, Kelvin, just finally, you know, when you think back, it took 8 years for Sue to persuade you. You know, how glad are you now that you finally gave in?
I am glad. A number of reasons. One, I know that Sue would not be fulfilled if she didn't have something like fostering. That I may not be it might not be as easy a life, for want of a better word. Mm-hmm. So yes, I'm glad that I did, and yes, I have lots of little, I don't know what you call them, wins. But when something occurs that they do, that you say, wow, yes, there's lots of them, isn't there? And that's what. Also helps and motivates and pleases me, yeah.
You've done things like building rabbit hutches with them, haven't you? And they all got that with the screwdrivers and the hammers and Avery's. And
yeah, because you've got lots of pets as well, haven't you? We've not talked about that yet. Yeah. Yeah. Tell us about all your animals that you have.
Well, we accumulated the animals after the children. We just had one dog, and then our youngest foster child was struggling with the idea of nurture. She didn't understand why we were like we were and why we sort of were able to give her things that she needed when her own family didn't. Mm-hmm. So she started off with one budgie that was in the house, and then we had a couple of budgies in the house, and then we ended up with an Avery with 8 budgies outside and now there's 6 because 2 have been rehomed because the girl one was a bit bossy with someone else. And then rabbits. We had ducks and they got rehomed because they're very mucky ducks. But they've got 3 rabbits that they look after in a big run in the garden with hutches, and that's an everyday thing. And we've also got 2 other dogs now, so we've got 3 dogs. They part of the responsibilities are making sure that those pets' needs are met. Mm. And they get feedback from the pets when they come, you know, they respond to the fact that the pets respond to them. I think pets are great for, you get the cuddly bit, but I mean, they may not be all right for every child, but they've certainly made a big difference to our children. Mm. And to them learning about responsibility and about routine when they've had a chaotic life, how important routines are and keeping things simple, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. So just to finish off, what would you both say the best things about fostering are?
The best is seeing the progress that both of the young people have made in this time. And it's visible progress. And that I feel quite proud. I'm not sure what I've done to get them that way. But, you know, I do feel proud that they've achieved that with our help.
Yeah, yeah. Sue, would you agree with that?
I agree. And for me, the thing that's best is that we love them and they love us. Mm. And that's the rest of it we can deal with, you know.
Yeah.
Sue and Kelvin, thank you so much for your time today. You've been wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.